From London, England, extracting the signal from the noise, it's theCUBE, covering Discover 2015. Brought to you by Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. Now your hosts, John Furrier and Dave Vellante.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We are here live in London for HP Enterprise, now called HPE. HPE Discover 2015, the first official Discover as part of the new entity, standalone HP Enterprise. This is theCUBE, our flagship program. We go out to the events, extract the signal from the noise. I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante, my co-host, Antonio Neri, Executive Vice President, General Manager of the EG Enterprise Group at HPE. Great to see you. I know you're super busy and you always come by to come on theCUBE, and I really appreciate it. Dave and I are always looking forward
great
to this talk.
I love like, coming here.
We're like
I love coming here.
Such just following you along and just watching you do such great things over
we
the
knew
years.
You when.
You know, we knew you when. Now you're
before big, you were a movie star.
Now you're, no. Now you're a movie star on the stage. Congratulations.
Nobody saw that, only us. Yeah. That was in the vault, sorry.
Congratulations on the keynotes, great, and the performance. Great stuff. Give us the quick highlights on EG performance, certainly the fresh perspective. I mean, you were operating as a single entity prior to the official date, November 1st, so, but now people are jazzed up. They're motivated. I hear words like, I want to win. We're going to be competitive. Yeah. You got great products. Talk about, encapsulate all summary real quick.
I mean, we're going through a very exciting time. Obviously launching a new company a month or so ago now, and be able to spend just out of the gate this amount of time with our customers is kind of unique. As you said, you know, the customers are very, very excited. We launched the new company here, a new brand, our values. But most importantly, we walk them to our strategy. The separation gave us purpose and focus. And the customers are very impressed about our focus, our innovation roadmap, and how we think about the future. But the enterprise group is at the core of the Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, is the growth engine, is the innovation engine. And if you look at the results of 2015, we actually had a very strong performance. We grew almost 9% last quarter in constant currency. Yeah. Every aspect of our business is growing, and we have the best product roadmap ever that we introduced in the last four or five years.
And 14% operating profit, which is 5 points above the target for the company, which I'm saying is, they're going to do better than that, but anyway.
It's sandbagging situation.
You can't say that. But
it sounds like
good.
A sandbagging
it's good to,
situation.
It's good to set expectations that you can beat.
It's good to have.
But we feel good. Actually, our employees have never been this confident, you know, in the sense that they can, you know, they can explain our strategy. Our four transformation areas are resonating very well. You know, you think about the study that, you know, the industry analysts do, what is Gartner, IDC. Yeah. They have us leading in most of the categories. And I think, you know, over the next couple of years, we're going to have a significant opportunity to continue.
You know, Dave
to
and I, owe, since, you know, we've been the 6th year doing theCUBE, and it's been really fun to watch. And we've always were like, proud of like looking at all the great innovation, but there's always been noise around the HP situation. Now that noise is gone, people feel like the shackles are off. But the bets that were being made years ago in 2010, 2011, hyper-converged was a term that was coined. Work in the ESSN, the group you were involved in, the chip work, the Gen 8, the moonshot, all those bets are paying off now. So congratulations to the team. Now it's going to be showcased as the successes. Mm-hmm. So I got to ask you, what's the next bet? We hear composable, you talk about IoT.
Infrastructure as code.
What's the next bet? What are you laying down for the next curve of growth?
Well, as we laid out here and before, right, is to help customers to the journey to the new style of business and be able to deliver against these four transformation areas. That's our bet. That's the core of our strategy. And the way we do that is to help customers define their roadmap. So when I talked yesterday, right, think about the hybrid world. How we help them define the right mix, how we help them power the right mix, and how we help them optimize the right mix, and use the power of the one Hewlett-Packard Enterprise against those objectives. And I think, you know, the way we are integrating our hardware and our products and services, our software, now is becoming clear to us that we have a great opportunity against those bets. But innovation is live and well in this company. Because to your point, when I spoke to you in 2011, 2012, we made a commitment and we delivered against those commitments.
You didn't waver.
Well, I think too, the synergy is interesting. We were talking off camera, you said I was skeptical. I guess so, I guess that's fair. But what really impresses me is you leapfrogged. That's the key, is you've shown innovation there. Now it's not shipping yet, so we'll see. but
it's shipping in the first quarter.
But very soon. So, but
first quarter?
Yeah, in the beginning of the 2000s.
And trickling out bits and pieces of things we've heard about, the machine and Memristor, and the architecture's now there. So you have today product that is different in the marketplace that we know you can ship, and you have legs in that. So talk about that a little bit. What synergy means to your business?
Yeah, it's all about speed and agility. It's all about time to value. And when we think about a workload-centric approach and the challenge that the customer have today, right, is how they deliver services quickly. And so, obviously, customers have mixed workloads, right? And the cloud has opened the doors to many people, right, to do things differently. And we felt that, you know, many customers want to have the control because of the data, security, and so forth. And we felt that there was a better way to implement cloud on-premise, still in a hybrid environment, with a platform that gives you that flexibility. Basically, a fluid pool of resources that a developer or a VP of operation can compose exactly to the need of the application, and then reduce waste, reduce over-provisioning, lower capex, and improve utilization. And by the way, maintain it in a simple way.
Yeah, so it's not speeds and feeds.
Absolutely not.
It's architectural.
Absolutely not. It's architectural.
And everybody has their own approach. You know, VC has its approach, that's cool. Oracle has its approach. You came up with something new.
But remember, we are the first to come with a converged infrastructure, right?
Well, right, and you guys sort of coined the term.
Yes.
Yep.
Right.
Yes.
And we learned a ton
of it. But one could have expected sort of incremental turn of the crank. That's not what this is.
Correct.
Explain that.
This is total, you know, leapfrog, total change in the way we think about it. So obviously, converged infrastructure was nothing more than putting together compute, storage, and networking in a prepackaged way, optimized for specific workloads like VDI, and that deliver business results. But when we thought about the challenge that customers are facing today, is how I bridge the old to the new, how I modernize my current infrastructure, how I deploy an infrastructure that's cloud ready, how I make the life of developers much easier, and ultimately really make a radical step forward in the way infrastructure should be deployed, provisioned, and managed. That's the principle of a Hewlett Packard Enterprise.
Well, so if I may, so we interviewed Steve Mills when he announced Pure, and he said, look, this is evolutionary. You're not saying that.
No, this is totally revolutionary. Think about it, you know, you have traditional IT, you have converge, then you have hyper-converge for a specific set of use cases. We think at the end of the day, the enterprise needs to become composable. Because ultimately, all the CIOs have to become service brokers. And at the end of the day, you have to abstract that complexity from the service broker and be able to give them a control point where they can compose their infrastructure to their specific needs. And that's totally a different way to think about infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. I think the nuance here, I want to just make sure I get that out there, and it's nuanced out, is that converged infrastructure doesn't go away in this consumption of the customer base.
No, it has its
so
place.
It's revolutionary, but it's not replacing converged infrastructure. They can still buy converged infrastructure solutions. It's just that the consumption of the cloud and how the apps are driving it.
Well, we think over time, with the innovation that we bring into the market after HPE Synergy, over time, people will adopt more this type of architecture for their infrastructure.
But and customers have a great choice. It's a road to the cloud. I mean, it's really cloud native.
We can support physical, virtualized, and containerized workloads in that infrastructure, full integrated lifecycle management, full integrated provisioning, right? And then with our cloud service broker announcement we made yesterday, now you have a complete, you know, pane of glass
so customer,
that you can control everything.
So a customer can choose how much they take a bite out of the apple of the new Synergy. They can go all in.
Right. It scales for thousands and thousands of dollars.
So they don't have to overcommit. There's not a risk for them.
You can start, you know, with a chassis and then you go from there. But the good news is what you're doing is like putting more resources available without being constrained by, you know, units. He said, I'm going to put this much compute, this much storage, this much fabric, and then you can compose it as you need. So you can increase capacity as you go.
They'll get addicted to it, and they'll want more.
Yeah. Give us the update on Apollo. Last couple of HP Discovers, we've done some unveilings. David Scott would do some unveilings, and you know, take over the world. You did the Apollo unveiling. Give us the update on Apollo.
Apollo has been a huge success. If you think about, you know, big data analytics, right, or hyperscale workloads, Apollo was designed to support both needs. And the incredible scalability that Apollo brings with the density, the power, efficiency, and the ability to do this in a very efficient way has been a huge success. In fact, we are the leader in high-performance computing in the market. If you think about supercomputer, we actually have 165 of the top 500 supercomputers around the globe. We are the market leader in the mid-market, in the mixed segment of the high-performance computing, and we've seen incredible growth. And customers love the flexibility that Apollo brings because actually you can customize it to the specific needs. Some customers want power, different type of power supplies. Some customers want different type of cabling. So we can give them all that flexibility to their specific data center needs. So Apollo has been a huge success, and we are excited about what's coming next.
So talk about the, I know you talk about the transformation areas, that's solution driven. We're seeing that the show is different this year. It's not by divisions. You can see the org chart by looking at the floor, but not here. I mean, you can see it's solutions
well,
based.
Well, Robert announced Edgeline today for me. It's my software guy.
But there's some technology vectors.
Yeah.
Right, that are exciting and that are also hyped up. IoT is one of them.
Yes.
It's super growth area, it's a no-brainer. People obviously see the path. Some technologies are rolling out, but there's some stuff people can do today. What's the vision for EG, Enterprise Group, HPE, for IoT? Yeah. How are you engaging with customers how on the consumption side, and what technologies are you rolling out?
Well, we made an announcement today, but let me start by stepping back and say, you know, IoT, depending on how you define the market, is a $100 billion market, right? Obviously, the sensor part of this is very easy. It's not that hard. But the ability to process that data in real time is the bigger challenge. IoT for me is a big data problem, right? And so what we announced today here at HPE Discover was the introduction of our Edgeline platform. And basically, you know, we introduced two new products that are computing at the edge in a partnership actually with Intel. So we have a great partnership with Intel. And we're going to use our Moonshot platform to continue to add new compute platforms for different type of use cases. You know, ruggedized, yeah, different type of verticals as we go forward. And, but also with the acquisition of Aruba, actually gives us a complete solution. Yeah. Be able to use, you know, beacons to understand where the data sits, and then be able to process that data at the edge so you can make real-time decisions and only move the data that you need in a centralized way. As we deploy the machine and other aspects of innovation, then you can start processing bigger amounts of data, and that's how the whole roadmap comes together, right?
Aruba's a home run there with this that acquisition. I mean, the upsell technology you have there is way beyond.
Well, I encourage you to go to the glass house.
It's really, really amazing.
See the use cases, right?
All right, so let's talk about the Moonshot, because when we first saw that box, we're like, I'm like, Dave, that's a God box. And we're like, eyes popping out. You know, our big data addiction that we have. We love data, we love big data. But one thing you nailed was the density.
Yeah.
And so that's an IoT problem opportunity, you know, connecting to the internet and density and power.
Right.
But so how are you guys going to resolve that? Obviously wireless could be one, but is that market developing? Are you going to go for the low-hanging fruit? Do you see manufacturing and machines?
Yeah, so we actually focus on several verticals. Healthcare is one of them. Manufacturing, the other one. Oil and gas is the other one. Interesting enough, there are always new opportunities, but I was just talking to one of our great customers, which is a reference, the Sauber Formula One team, which uses our Moonshot to analyze wind tunnel data. And think about, you know, when you have a Formula One driver going around the circuit, the amount of data they collect from their cars, in general speaking, they have between 600 and 1,000 sensors. They are collecting data real time, going back into the pits, the Moonshot is sitting there, processing that data real time, and giving information to the team directors and to the drivers about how they can optimize the performance on the circuit.
In real time.
That's kind of a unique case, but think about, you know, oil and gas, you know, to drill a new hole, it takes millions of dollars, right? Yeah. And so you want to make sure you drill the right hole. You don't want to miss that hole.
It's hard to put a data center in that hole too.
Yeah, exactly. So how you bring a data center power to process that amount of data from sensors that are collecting that amount of data as they drill the hole. So they make sure they steer that drill in the right direction. So healthcare is another example. We had a great customer example yesterday with Philips Healthcare, where we are helping them define the right mix, process the right amount of data to improve the life of the people, which means basically, you know, completing medicines faster, right?
Can we get your take on what's going on in the industry? I mean, the titans of business are making moves. You got Dell buying EMC, you got IBM buying the weather company, you know, totally different, you know, directions. You know, it remains to be seen what Cisco's going to do. Oracle's obviously pretty clear what their strategy is. Lenovo maybe needs some more time to bake out. HPE now, it's a different company, new balance sheet, excited about that. What's your take on what's going on in the industry?
I mean, Meg and I were talking about this today with our customers, right? It's fascinating to see kind of similar companies, right? If you think about the potential combination of Dell EMC with Hewlett Packard Enterprise on the other side, two very diverse strategies,
ladies,
you know,
and
Meg was fun. He had a nice way to say, you know, one of us will be right, and we think we're going to be right because we feel, you know, being very focused on what we do, and that's the focus of Hewlett Packard Enterprise, is be very focused on the enterprise market and being agile and nimble. And if you think about it, you know, now Hewlett Packard Enterprise is a very stable company, right? We separated. We have done this extremely well, seamlessly, with no disruption for our customers, and we have an incredible agenda, and we know exactly what we want to play and have to win, but ultimately help our customers, right? That's what it's all about. And that's why, you know, unlocking the value of the app and the data through the full transformation area, bring that right innovation in an integrated solution between hardware, software, and services is our play.
And it's a big market. I mean, you know, it's maybe not one or the other. Maybe
it's $1 trillion.
You know, it's a strategy
market.
And another strategy.
It's $1 trillion.
But you like where you are now.
Yes, I am. You know, I would rather be here.
You've been with HP for many, many years. We always talk about it on theCUBE. You've been there from the beginning, success story. And you know, when I was there back in the 80s and 90s, it was, you know, the kind of company where it was very engineering focused and had great technology, but they weren't risk takers on being first in market. But when they saw the market, they really go hard and would win.
Yep.
And we saw that they were never in the PC business, became number one. They see the straight and narrow, they go hard. So you guys made a decision on cloud, okay? Because you know what you know, and you know what you're good at. Partnering, you sell other people's software, number one reseller in VMware, Red Hat, and among other things, you had OpenStack, Brooming. So that's the strategy, that's very clear, so congratulations. But one thing that's kind of not clear, I want to get your take on, is the networking. Mm-hmm. Networking has always been phenomenal at HP, still is, but with Aruba, interesting perspective, they've got a kick-ass solution, right? And they're like so strategic. It may not be big numbers revenue-wise, but so much potential with the data, the access, edge devices, mobile.
Right.
So, and the core of the network, SDN's kind of like, is it baked? What's your take on all this networking?
First of all, I'm super excited to have Aruba as a part of the Hewlett Packard Enterprise family. Domor and Kirti Malkote and that team are phenomenal. You know, I think I was right because I was the proponent of that acquisition. Meg was super supportive. But the reality, when you look at the networking market, it's roughly $35 billion, making it rounded. And half of that market is actually the campus market. And
it's
so,
what?
The campus market, right? So, it's $17, $18 billion market that you think about it, right, is going to go through a massive refresh cycle with 802.11ac, the need to provide security access to the network, and the ability to leverage these new technologies, right, to provide contextual access to the network. And that's what Aruba does very well, is a software company at the core that has incredible assets like ClearPass, AirCentral, and Meridian with a big data analytics platform to be able to optimize that experience in a way that hasn't done before. And you know, and we're ranked the number one in the campus market for wire and wireless, which hasn't happened in 25 years.
Yeah, I agree that.
So, whether you think about traditional networking access, whether you think about IoT, that's what Aruba gave us, the opportunity to really disrupt that industry and provide a great experience to our
customers.
It's
interesting, it's like you mentioned the groundbreaking move with Synergy. Things are flipped around on networking. The wireless used to be the last stop from the core of the network, now it's driving in. So you agree that wireless can drive into the core and dictate and connect in that way.
Yeah, and I will say, ultimately, you know, listen, you are here, you're connected real time. I don't see any cables connected to your except the power, right? And so that's how, you know, it's enabling workplace productivity. That's our major transformation area number four, how we enable workplace productivity in a secure way, providing that end-to-end experience, which includes the application, the infrastructure, right? And the services around it. And then our data center offering is very strong, and we have seen double-digit growth in the last several quarters. So I think Aruba has given us
the opportunity to
retool that portfolio in a way that we were not able to do before.
Yeah. Congratulations, great, we love that deal. Now, security you mentioned, and we had Sue on earlier.
Great.
Security is a big data problem too. It's also an opportunity to use the big data, and wireless can be a part of that. So it's all kind of coming together. What's going on with the security group? I mean, what's your vision there?
Well, Mike Nefkens today, you know, talked about security, right? You know, listen, we already have 5,000 professionals in many security centers around the globe helping customers, you know, protect themselves and recover faster when a intrusion or a you know, an event has taken place. Obviously, we use our services portfolio, our partnership with FireEye and others, but as well our software capability, like ArcSight Fortify, to provide that end-to-end capability. Security is a big problem, right? But to your point, we can use big data analytics to solve security problems. And that's something that we can do because we have both set of
assets. And you got composable infrastructure now with wireless.
To process that data faster.
The transfer areas are kind of drilling down. It's great, we're going right down the box here. Final one, help me understand the workplace productivity.
Yeah.
Because when I think of that, I mean, I love the messaging and all the kind of products, but I have to kind of dig through it. When I think of the workplace, but I think of future of work, which is mostly driven by the narrative around CRM vendors driving, you know, this is the, you know, CRM, ERP, but it's different here. It's more app-driven. So what is that pillar? What is that transformation area all about? Can you clarify that?
So we want to make sure your employees, your partners, your customers are as productive as they can be. And as you know, the professional and the personal lives are becoming one. And ultimately is an experience you want to provide, right? So how you provide them the right access to the network, how you provide them the right access to the data through an application, and then how you wrap all the security and the compliance around it. And so with our infrastructure, with Aruba, with our security and our software, we think we can provide a unique end-to-end experience and also help customers develop the applications that are mobile first, cloud first. And so like AppPulse, Hewlett Packard Enterprise AppPulse that Robert covered today is an example of how to improve that experience. And obviously, together with Aruba now, we are able to provide that end-to-end experience.
And that's a solution, transformation area. It's pretty much, you know, integrated in internally.
Yes.
Kind of like.
And so that's why if you walk here in that transformation number four, you actually can see several use cases where we bring the entire solution together.
Look, I got to ask the question near and dear to your heart. The services market explodes under these transformation areas. Each one, it's not a product. Yep. That's why I'm trying to get my hands on what's the product. There's no one product. It's kind of like a
It's a solution-driven conversation. Services plays a huge role to bring that solution together, but ultimately you need hardware, software, and services to deliver that solution. And that's why HPE is positioned for success.
So how's the vibe in the professional services group within HPE? And also the partners, because we had some partners on with the cloud group, they're jazzed about it.
Right.
But the lines are blurring. A VAB and a VAR and a reseller and a distributor, they're all kind of like.
Listen, all the, I mean, the channel partners have to transform themselves. Mm. That's clear, right? And they're coming to us and help me transform to this new style of IT. And the good news, HP, I made this commitment to our channel partners. Whatever we do to enable our field, we're doing the exact same thing to enable the channel partners. Whether it's training, certification, access to financial services capabilities, which is very, very important, or actually access into advisory capabilities, because not all the partners can make that capital investment. As you know, it's a big capital investment. So they can use RTS Consulting to really drive that advisor with their customers, which ultimately are our customers. So we consider this a continuous, you know, go-to-market, and we want to make sure they transform themselves as we transform our customers.
They have to, right?
They have to.
They're going to disappear.
Right.
If they don't,
so I got to ask you the leadership question, because you know, you're a great leader, and you have the history of HP, now the new HPE. A lot of new people coming into the company. Notice some new executives, new talent, technical talent with the DevOps, and you have some new managers. What's the hiring strategy? What's the strategy you're taking to retain key people, get new fresh blood in? Because the requirements are changing, there's gaps in talent.
Yeah, and I think, you know, that's one of the things that we'll continue to work over time. Meg and I were talking today to our channel partners, and we were saying training and certification were not at the top of the agenda 4 years ago. Training and certification and getting the right talent, the right person with the right skill set, with the right attitude and the right job at the right time is a priority number one today. So obviously we work on a labor pyramid. We have incredible engineering talent. We have an incredible go-to-market, but obviously you want to bring new ideas. And one of the things we do also is curate the Silicon Valley. So we have our Pathfinder program. We also brought here some of the companies, startups that we invest, so they get exposed to the customer needs, because ultimately we want them to be part of the ecosystem of Hewlett Packard Enterprise in our solutions, right? You don't need to necessarily go and acquire this company. What you need to do is partner with them. So, you know, and we see now many more people interested to come work for Hewlett Packard Enterprise because they understand the purpose of the company, they understand the strategy, and they understand the
Well, they see the clarity. It's cool and relevant. You got Docker here, you got DevOps, you got some technology, transformation areas.
That's right.
It's back to the growth engine of HP.
Yeah.
So I got to ask you about the STEM and leadership area around. We saw some signs of women technology. What's going on there? We're seeing a lot of, we were at the Grace Hopper celebration in Houston this year doing a cube there. 16,000 women, and it wasn't just women managers. These are developers, DevOps developers. Hoodies. So, huge workforce injection of ladies, women in tech.
Yeah. Well, we have been very supportive of women in tech, big diversity programs at HP, college hiring, right? One of the events I'm very proud to sponsor every year is what we call Code Wars, where basically we bring high school kids into the HPE campus, and we have this whole day event, right, where we give them a problem for them to code, and then, you know, they get exposed to our technology. We get exposed to some really cool kids.
Yeah.
But the point is that HP has a history of being part of the community, right?
Yes.
Making a contribution, global citizenship, diversity. And so, and as you know, our CEO is a woman and a very successful leader.
Yeah.
And so every time we have a Discover event, we have a Women in Technology event that Meg hosts with the women's around here. We had an event yesterday morning. It was very impressive. So that's our commitment. That's what we do. It's part of our culture.
Yeah, we'd love to get cover more of that.
Yeah.
We'd love that. We have a Women in Tech section now we're doing. It's very important to us, too. We're very passionate about that, so I just want to make sure you got that out. Congratulations. Final thoughts on the show.
It's been an incredible 3 days. We are very excited at what's going on the floor. As I said at the beginning, this is a great time for Hewlett Packard Enterprise. We have made history because separating a $120 billion company is not easy, right? Mm-hmm. We did it in a record time, very efficiently. Customers see the value of the separation. Our technology, our roadmap has never been better. We have a clear strategy, and we are excited about the opportunity to go compete and win in the marketplace.
I also want you to final comment on You made me think of a good question. The IT team that made it happen.
Yes.
One of the most impressive things that I saw that's kind of, I won't say buried, but if you know HP, you know they have really always had a great
IT. Scott Bradley and team have done a phenomenal job. In fact, yesterday we played a documentary on how we did the separation, right?
Yeah.
And showing the faces of planning.
War rooms.
The moment, war rooms, the time we launched the separation. It has been an incredible experience. Honestly, it has been a little bit emotional because, you know, I have been with the company for 21 years, always on the HP side, and seeing what we can do as a company is kind of unique. So I felt very proud about what our IT team did for us, but what it does for every customer every single day.
Yeah. I mean, I felt emotional only, I was there 9 years, I felt emotional, but it's the right thing, and you can see the results. So congratulations.
Well, thank you.
On all the success, and looking forward to talking again. Antonio Neri, Executive Vice President at HP Enterprise Group here at HPE, HP Discover, this is theCUBE. Be right back with more after this short break.